Hello everyone, today we will discuss about the topic dynamics of fluid flow. As you already know about fluid mechanics, it deals with three types of study. The first study is fluid statics, wherein the fluid is considered at rest state. The second type of study is fluid kinematics, where your fluid is in motion, but you only study about the velocity and acceleration. The forces causing the motion is not taken into picture. The third type of study is fluid dynamics, or it is also called as fluid kinetics. Here, the fluid flow is considered and also the forces causing the motion is studied. It is based on Newton's second law of motion, and mainly Newton's second law is used for deriving the equations. The fluid here is assumed to be incompressible and non-viscous. When I say non-viscous, it means it is an ideal kind of fluid flow. Now, we will talk about equations of motion. According to Newton's second law, the total force acting in any direction is equal to the mass of the fluid element, which is multiplied with acceleration in that direction. Now, you can talk about any direction. I am talking about, say, direction x. In the x direction, fx will be equal to m into acceleration in that direction. This fx is the summation of all the forces which are acting in x direction. Now, there are various types of forces which are considered in the fluid flow, some of them being gravity force, pressure force, viscosity force, the force due to the turbulence in the fluid, and the force due to compressibility. When you add all these forces, they give you the force fx in x direction. So, fx is equal to fg plus fp plus fv, viscosity, ft, turbulent force, fc, compressibility force, all in x direction. Now, if I neglect this force fc, which is your force due to compressibility, then your total equation remains as fg plus fp plus fv and ft. This type of equation is called as Reynolds equation of motion, which we'll be deriving in later chapter. If I consider ft to be negligible, then fx is equal to fg plus fp and fv in x direction. This equation is called as Navier-Stokes equation. It is also called as NS equation. Now, suppose if we say that the fluid is idle, then the viscous force fv will become equal to 0. In that case, fx becomes equal to fg and fp. The summation of these two forces is the total force acting in that direction. This type of equation, or these forces when they are considered, that equation formation is called as Euler's equation of motion. Now, we are going to derive next what is Euler's equation of motion. For that, I have taken a fluid element. Now, it as you already know from the chapter Kinematics of Fluid Flow, wherein you cannot study a fluid particle because it is difficult to follow a particle. So what we do is we take a control volume. There is quite a amount of fluid flowing over here. In that, we have just taken a small portion, which is called as a fluid control volume. And here I'm calling it as fluid element, wherein I'm going to study the effect of forces on these elements from the two sides. Now, here I consider that the direction of flow is upward. So the pressure force which is acting in this direction will be P plus dA. dA is the cross-section area of this fluid element. Now, suppose if I have to calculate the pressure which is exerted on this side. Now, how would be pressure on this side coming into picture? When the fluid is flowing in upward direction, you have some velocity with which the fluid flows. Now, obviously in this portion, there will be some accumulation of fluid which is called as pressure. So, if I consider the accumulation in this zone and if I want to calculate the pressure which is exerted by the fluid particles over here, then it will be pressure P plus. There will be some rate of change of pressure over this distance or over the length of the fluid element ds, which I can call as dou P by dou S. Dou is small change in the pressure. So this small change in pressure per unit length. Now, since we are adding a pressure term with another pressure term, the unit has to remain same, which is Newton per meter square. Hence, I'll be multiplying with the same quantity ds, so that the unit meter gets cancelled out over here, and what remains is the unit Newton per meter square. Hence, the term P plus dou P by dou S into ds. Now, since I'm considering the force acting over here, or the pressure force as I would call it, hence I will multiply this term with the cross section area of this section dA. So the pressure force on the other end will be P plus dou P by dou S into ds into dA. Now, the direction over here which I've considered is any random direction S. Hence, in the vertical direction Y, we have to consider the fluid element's weight. Now, you know that the basic formula of weight is M into G, and M is nothing but rho into V, which is the formula for mass by considering the density. So here this becomes rho G, which is your M into G, which has a formula rho G V. So it becomes rho G into volume, which is dA into dS. So the total weight of the element acting in the downward direction is rho g dA dS. Now weight will always act in the y direction irrespective of the alignment of this fluid element. Hence I have marked an angle theta over here, which is the angle between the direction of the force acting and the direction in which the fluid flow is taking place. Now here what is marked in this figure B is this angle theta over here. This side is dS, and this vertical direction, as you can see over here, I am calling it as dz. So this side will become dz. This side is ds as I have marked, and this angle is theta. So this is the diagram for knowing the forces on a fluid element. Now, when you have to derive the Euler's equation of motion, you are going to only take into picture two forces. One will be gravity force and one will be the pressure force. Now, along the streamline S, as you have seen in the diagram, there will be three types of forces as we have discussed. One is the pressure force PdA in the direction of flow. One will be the pressure force P plus dou P by dou S into dS, and this entire pressure multiplied with the area, making it pressure force in the direction opposite to the direction of flow, as I have shown you in the diagram. And last is the weight of the element. Weight is given as rho GV. V is written as cross-section area into the length of that fluid element. So this becomes rho g dA dS. Now, if I apply Newton's law of motion along the S direction, it will be Fs is equal to m into As using Newton's second law of motion. Now, the total forces acting is going to be PdA, which is acting along the direction of flow. This force was acting in the opposite direction, and obviously rho g dA dS is also acting in the downward direction. If you see this figure, rho g dA dS is acting in the downward direction. Now if I align this force on this S axis, it will be rho g dA dS into cos of theta. Now if you observe the direction, the down direction will be downwards. Hence I have taken here minus rho g dA dS cos theta. And on the right hand side, mass is also written as rho into V, and V is dA into dS into AS. AS is acceleration in S direction. Now, S direction acceleration can be written as dV by dt. It is just the rate of change of velocity. Velocity is also a function of space and time. Here, space coordinate is S. So, I can also write this as dou V by dou S into ds by dt plus dou v by dou t. Now I am showing over here that v is a function of space and time. Now here what I have done is, since I have written dou v by dou s, and if you look here, the denominator is t. Hence I need to multiply with ds so that this term gets cancelled out, and what remains in the denominator is dt. Now ds by dt can also be written as v, which is velocity. So I can write this term as v dou v by dou s plus dou v by dou t. Now if you see here, I consider the flow is steady, so dou v by dou t term becomes equal to 0. Therefore as will become v dou v by dou s. If I substitute this equation 2 in equation 1, then what I get is p into dA minus PdA, if I open the bracket, minus dou P by dou S into dS dA minus rho G dA dS cos theta is equal to rho dA dS into V dou V by dou S. Now these two terms, positive, negative, they get cancelled out. And if I divide throughout by rho dA dS, what remains is minus dou P by dou S minus G cos theta is equal to V dou V by dou S. And a rho term gets added in the denominator here. If I take all the terms to the right hand side, then what remains is dou P by rho into dou S plus G cos theta plus V dou V by dou S equal to 0. Now from the figure B, as you have already seen in this figure, from this figure, if you see, cos of theta will be equal to dz upon ds. From this figure, cos theta will be dz by ds. When I substitute over here, I get 1 upon rho dp by ds plus g dz by ds plus V dv by ds equal to 0. Now why have I substituted dou as d? Because every term is a function of only one term. P is a function of s only. In that case, you can convert partial differential equation into ordinary differential equation. So what remains is dp by rho plus g dz plus v dv is equal to 0. This equation 3 is called as Euler's equation of motion.